Okay, now we look at the lobe. Most textbooks say we have four different lobes. Some textbook, if they say five, means they include in this one. This one called insula, I-N-S-U-L-A. The insula, okay, let's look at the insula first. Most textbooks don't call it lobe. Sometimes you see five lobes, and that's including this one. You have to peel the frontal away from the temporal. This area, small cortical area, that's the insula. We will talk about this area when we go to the sensory system, because your chemical senses, your olfactory, gustatory, these two chemical senses, eventually they go to here, that's your insula. The other four lobes, okay, frontal, parietal, occipital, temporal. Let's look at the temporal first. Temporal is where you touch your ear, okay, inside, that's the temporal lobe. So the temporal lobe's function is auditory function. So each lobe pick one to two functions to talk about. We don't have time to cover all of them. And occipital lobe, that's the occipital lobe. Its function is visual. So your visual information gonna go to your two eyes. From your two eyes, gonna go through your cranial nerve number two and go to the thalamus. From the thalamus, go to the occipital lobe. So you have the left and right occipital lobe. And your brain are lateralized. It's lateralized, so the left brain controls the right side body, the right brain controls the left side body. It's not just human, all animals are like this. So if the patient have a stroke on the left brain, it paralyzes the right side body. It's lateralized. And you say, well, the right eye gonna see the right side, left eye gonna see the left side. No, because our two eyes are in the front. Unless you are rabbit. Rabbit is one eye here, the other is eyes here. And they see almost 360 degree. And human, we are predators. So all the predators, they put two eyes in the front. And the reason is we want to see the 3D vision. So the 3D is created by the brain. When the outside world is 3D, they go to the retina. Retina is a piece of paper. It's a piece of paper, it's two-dimensional. So you have to, it's mathematically impossible to transfer all the information from 3D to 2D. You have to lose something. So you lose the depth perception. And the depth perception is recreated by the brain. The brain have to use the image, go to your right eye, go to your left eye. So when you close your right eye, you close your left eye, you look at something, and you close the both eyes, you found the object jump. And the reason is there's small angle difference. So you're gonna have two images. And your brain uses those two images to compare them to recreate the depth perception. So your depth perception is created by your brain. And because of that, so if the object put around here, well, pretty much you're going to go to the left eye, go to the right eye, go to both eyes, you're going to see them. So the brain could not use the right side, right eye, left brain, and left eye, right brain. So you have to use the visual field. So if this object comes from your right visual field, this object gonna go to the both eyes, but eventually will be analyzed on your left visual cortex. If it come from the left side, left visual field, eventually will be analyzed on the right visual cortex. So that's how they distinguish their function. Now let's go to the parietal lobe, this one. Parietal lobe is big. In the parietal lobe, let's look at one function called somatosensory. A lot of sensory function go to the parietal lobe. So somatosensory, this is around here, this line. And not this, this is called the central sulcus. It's the separation between the frontal lobe and parietal lobe. We're looking at this. This is called the post-central gyrus. Gyrus, the wrinkles in the brain have name. The gyrus is moving out, and moving in is called the sulcus. So post-central gyrus, that's this one. And this is where the somatosensory cortex is located. And when we look at it, you found, oh, you have a whole body map. A whole body map. So if I touch your face, this neuron fire, you feel your face being touched. I shake your hand, this neuron fire, you feel like your hand being touched. So you have a whole body map represent different body part from your face to your leg. And in all this area, it represents the whole body, but when you look at the size, you find a lot of neurons. All the cortex, they are neurons. All the neurons, a lot of neurons analyze information from your face, from your hand, and your body is big, but not too many neurons analyze information from your body. Yeah, it tell you your brain really, really prefer your face and your hand. That affect the resolution, the pixel. Let's use the digital camera to think about it. So when 15 years ago, when we just have the digital camera, they have small pixel number. So the sensor size is about the same, and they don't have too many pixels. So each pixel is big. And the result is the resolution is low, right? Because each pixel is big. And nowadays, we have those, I don't know how many megapixels you have, a million or 10 millions, and each pixel is small. When each pixel is small, the resolution is pretty, pretty high because each pixel only covers a very small area. The same here. So when you put so many neurons, analyze the space, very small area, each neuron covers a very small area. So the resolution is pretty, pretty, pretty high. And that explains your face, your finger. These are the sensitive body parts. The resolution is high, especially the lips, very sensitive. Compared with your back, your body, your leg, these are low megapixel digital camera. So each pixel is big. So their resolution is lower compared with your finger, compared with your face. And we'll talk more about this in the sensory system. It turned out your brain just could not afford to make your whole body equally sensitive. It need to pick some to make them sensitive body part. So they pick your face, your finger, and let your body, as long as they can detect something, they'll be good enough. And the sensory system use the same strategy for not just somatosensory, also your visual system. Visual system, it put the fovea, that's the very small area, you have very sharp vision resolution, that's in the center part of your retina. And the peripheral vision, your peripheral vision actually not so good, resolution is low. And they are used to detect the object. So if you want to see the object clearly, you actually have to move your fovea to the target. And that's why outside of the eyeball, you have six muscles. Their job is to quickly move the eyeball fovea to focus on the target so you can see clearly. And your brain keep using, your sensory system keep using the same strategy. And the reason is you only have 100 billion of neurons. It sounds a lot, but pretty much every neuron have their job to do. And you only have this small amount of neuron analyze information from your body. You cannot afford to make the whole body equally sensitive. You have to pick the sensitive body part and not so sensitive body part. And your brain pick the lips, the face, and the hand, the sensitive body part. So they put more neurons analyze information from there. And your visual system put the fovea. They pick the fovea, that's the sensitive high resolution area, and make the others low resolution area because you only have limited amount of neurons. And scientists draw the human's body based on the number of neurons. If I draw your body based on neurons, it's going to look like this. So you're going to have a huge hand, huge face, especially the lips, and small body. It's called the homunculus. And this affects our social behavior. You found when you want to show your affection to your significant others, you hug them, you kiss them, right? Because that's our sensitive body part. And these are the not-so-sensitive body part. And it's not just human, also other animals like the rabbit, the cat, you found they put 90% of neurons, analyze information from the head, not much the body. And it makes sense because for them, okay, if they need to lose something, they don't want to lose something, but if you really need to lose something, okay, you cut a leg, cut a limb, they can survive. But if you cut the head, it's game over. So they need to put a lot of neurons to analyze information from the head to protect the head instead of the limb. So the same strategy for high-level species like a monkey, the human, we are the same. Okay, now let's go to the frontal lobe. This area is the frontal lobe. The frontal lobe, we're going to pick two functions to talk about. The first one is called the motor. The motor function is located around here. So this is called the precentral gyrus in anatomy. The precentral gyrus, so this moving out area. This is the central sulcus. This is the precentral gyrus. And we just talk about somatosensory. This is in the post-central gyrus. So this is in the parietal lobe. This is in the frontal lobe. Actually, they connect together, side by side. But this is the frontal lobe area. So this is the motor cortex. When you look at the motor cortex, you found you also have the whole body map. And this time it's not analyzed information. That's the sensory. This is the motor, so they control the muscle. You also have a lot of neurons control the face muscle, control the hand muscle. And all these are small muscles. Small muscles for delicate movement. Think about the human facial expression. We have very complicated facial expression. When you look at the person's face, it tells you a lot of information. And human can do such complicated facial expression because we have a lot of small muscles in the face and they need very delicate control. So we have a lot of neurons control those facial muscles. Similar for finger, we can play very complicated finger movement sequence. So we can play piano, we can play violin, you can tie your shoes. This is all due to the finger. You cannot tie your shoes with your feet because these are big muscles. And these are big muscles, so they don't have to have too many neurons control them. So every time this neuron fire, that muscle contract. And for those big muscles, their advantage is they can produce a big power. And so in your back, your leg, these are big muscles. They are not delicated, but their function is to support your body and for your movement. For your finger, for your face, they have different functions. So they are not so powerful, but they are able to create delicate movement. So you can have very complicated facial expression, very complicated finger movement. So the big muscle, small muscle, big motor control, small motor control. They call the motor unit. The motor unit is the motor neuron, and with all the muscle fiber, it innervates. The facial part and the finger part tend to have small motor units. And the body part, the leg part, have a bigger motor unit. And they have different function. Now let's go to this part. This part is called the prefrontal cortex. Prefrontal cortex is in your forehead. So when we talk about prefrontal cortex, we have to talk about this person, Gage. He lived in the 19th century, and he worked in a railroad company. And he was a very responsible for work. He always go to check the explosive. And one day when he was checking those explosives, his colleagues triggered the explosive. So what happened is this metal staff, this big, go from his zygomatic bone, that's the cheekbone, move in and go out from the temporal lobe. It completely knocked out his prefrontal cortex. And after the accident, he survived. And after 3 weeks, he completely recovered. And everyone was happy. He went back to his company, they gave him back his job, and looked like nothing happened, except he had a small scar. And he does not affect his motor function, and when he feel hungry, he will eat, when he feel thirsty, he will drink, and does not affect his language function, no motor impairment, because nowadays we know that it's not in this area. Right? Look like you don't need this brain area, prefrontal cortex, this area. And gradually, people find his colleagues complain he's not the Gage we knew anymore. Because he used to be a very responsible for worker, and turned out, after the accident, they tell him, okay, you have to do this, and 1 year in, the other year out. They just could not trust him anymore. So eventually, they have to fire him, and he went through a few jobs, he could not keep them for the same reason. And he also abandoned his family. He has family, wife with 3 beautiful kids. He abandoned them. He got into alcohol addiction a lot. And the last job he can find is he worked in the circus. So every day they gave him the metal staff. He showed people his hole. That's what he did for the rest of his life. And after he died, they took his skull. This is his skull. And that's the metal staff totally damaged, ruined his life. So what's the function of prefrontal cortex? High level reasoning, decision making. The only human can do that. You can think about your future, plan for your future, because you have the frontal lobe. No other animals can do that. So that's the unique part of the frontal lobe, prefrontal cortex. Protect well of your prefrontal cortex. Also, this is the brain area mature pretty late. It takes about 18 years to mature. Okay, let's take a break.